Morning. Thank you for coming to this talk. Stand a little bit away from the podium and hope this is working.
Which it seems to be.
Good. So I'm going to go through kind of a little bit about the state of autism genetics today and then talk a little bit about some follow-up studies on a particular gene that we've invested a lot of time and energy in. Kind of building this idea of how can we do better around pharmacotherapies for autism and related disorders. I'll talk about IGF-1 briefly, and there is a shared patent, so that's sort of a disclosure. And I don't need to this is really a context slide of a so-called personalized medicine, also known as precision individualized P4 or T4 translational medicine. And the key about it is biomarkers, so-called test before you treat. It's not a new idea. Hippocrates said it's more important to know about the person than about the disease, which was sort of this idea of individualized medicine. And in many disorders, and autism is one of them, we don't have any pharmacotherapies for core symptoms. It's not to say the behavioral interventions aren't out there. They're actually out there and they work somewhat. But in terms of the next generation, we're just not there. And the question is, kind of the foundational question in the field, and it's true of many complex psychiatric disorders, is, can we even succeed in getting a clinical trial to work if we take all comers? In an etiologically, neurobiologically, highly heterogeneous disorder, do you really expect that the same compound is going to affect everybody in a positive way, right? And if the answer to that is no, then you're always going to have trouble, even with a drug that actually works, you're going to have serious trouble actually showing that it works, because you really need to put it in the subset of individuals that have the neurobiology that is actually kind of dysregulated that drug can treat. Right, so that really is, I think, a foundational question in autism, and it's almost certainly true of many other psychiatric and neurodevelopmental disorders. Right, so if we can think about biomarkers and subgrouping and stratification and so on, are we going to actually move this along much more rapidly? And even as you subphenotype or stratify individuals, can you also learn about biology from those individuals that will actually lead to the next generation of therapeutics? Right, so that's kind of the tension. And when you think about biomarkers, obviously the lab tests are what we think about traditionally, but now we have a lot of neurophysiological biomarkers, EEGs and so on, and I'll talk a lot about genetic testing. I'll talk a little bit about novel lab tests. That's just by way of introduction. And the reason there is a fairly substantial focus on the genetics of psychiatric and neuropsychiatric disorders is that heritability is quite high for anything you could think of. Be it substance use, alcohol use, nicotine addiction, they're all non-zero, right? Certainly autism, schizophrenia, bipolar, depression, right? And we have tools, and this is the group that's done so much of the work driving that field forward, we have tools to actually find those genes, be they common or rare variation, while other factors that are important, like environment, we don't yet have the tools. We don't fully have the tools yet. And I think that's why there's been a lot of focus on genetics. And when we think about genetics, this is my go-to slide about the two key dimensions that we have to worry about. One is the frequency of the variant you're talking about. Is it a common variant like a SNP, or is it a rare variant or very rare variant? And the second dimension is, what's the effect of that variant? Is it Mendelian, basically fully penetrant, causes a disease, or is it a gene of very, very modest effect, right? And when you kind of look at it that way, what you can immediately figure out is this part of the space is really inaccessible. Things that are both very rare and have tiny effects, we're just simply not going to find because of the sample size would have to be enormous, right? This part of the curve probably isn't part of autism, right? If something is a common variant that has a very high effect size, it's not going to exist in the population, on the autosomes at least, with any appreciable length of time, right? It's going to undergo purifying selection. Even if there's just moderate risk, common variation undergoes profound purifying selection, doesn't persist in the population, right? So we can also kind of ignore this in autism. In Alzheimer's disease, you can't ignore it because APOE is very common and has high effect sizes, right? But Alzheimer's disease occurs after reproduction, right? This is kind of the, like the Buddha said, the middle path. Common variation with low effect. And rarer variation that could have major effect. And what we know about autism is that both play an important role. So this is a work that came out from the Swedish collaboration that showed that SNP and common variation heritability accounted for about half of the total liability for autism. And other things, de novo mutations, non-additive variation, rare inherited, accounted for another about 10%, and there's another 40% unaccounted for. And we use the word unaccounted for rather than environment, because that old model of genetics and environment isn't the same as we think about environment now. It's not PBA in your water bottle. It really is things that are not genetic fall into the extra terms of these models, and that can include mitochondrial effects, maternal effects, stochastic things, measurement errors, environment truly, G by E goes somewhere in there, both correlation and interaction, where they go exactly depends. So this is really an unknown at this point, what makes up that. And the state of the art for common variation in autism is, as soon as Mark Daly publishes it, you will know. So the PGC has systematically, PGC Autism Consortium systematically put together several thousand samples, and they have some things that are probably so close to genome-wide significant, but with the completion of the Danish blood spot study, and also again incorporating the PGC data, there are real findings in that data set. It'll be the first time in autism we have GWAS findings that are very reliable, which is a warning to all. You probably all know this, but if you read a paper about an association study in autism, it's probably not true, right? If you get a grant that says gene X has been associated with autism, it's probably not true. So that's a secret, but now it's an open secret. So just to give you a flavor of what we can expect over time, we'll go to this other paper in schizophrenia showing with 50,000 plus samples showing 108 loci, genome-wide significant loci in schizophrenia, and that really has been transformative in the field. The problem with this sort of finding, as with all findings of low effect, is mapping the variation to specific biological changes and understanding the biology that they then create. And that is, I think, the challenge of the field today. As more and more GWAS data comes in, that's actually very reliable. You're talking about SNPs that have effect sizes, 1.1-ish. So tiny effect sizes. We often don't know the direction of the effect. What gene is specifically being impacted and in which direction or what region of the genome? And so that's something that many groups and certainly the Broad is putting very big effort in to try and figure out how to try to turn these genetic findings into biology in kind of a linear way. This is one attempt from the Common Mind Consortium where Sinai and Penn and Pitt put all their brain bank samples for schizophrenia together, and so the sample size is about 500 brains in the brain bank. RNA-seq from this is one brain region, second brain region is completed now. Every sample has microarray GWAS, every sample is now getting whole genome or whole exome sequencing, every sample is part of PsycEncode, so there's a vast data set together with Common Mind. And within the Common Mind, you can begin to relate GWAS hits in schizophrenia to changes in expression in the brain. And the estimate is that about 20% of the GWAS findings that we looked at in Common Mind have an obvious effect on specific genes in the region. Example, genotype by expression levels. And some of them, many of them, unfortunately, the GWAS signal maps to a region, multiple genes are being up or down, but some of them, the gene that's being impacted by the SNP is a single gene, and we have a direction. The SNP made it go up, made it go down. Someday we'll be able to say it made a change in splicing or it didn't. But then, if you know that furin, as an example, is down-regulated in schizophrenia, you can kind of then model that. And this isn't a zebrafish, right? So beginning to tie together a GWAS finding to the genes that are being implicated and the direction of the effect, and then doing biology, right? So we're just starting that. And obviously, doing that and figuring out how to do that in a high-throughput way is going to be critical, and as you know, the Broad is kind of leading that. When I say Broad, I mean all the various institutes that are in the neighborhood. For me, they're all okay. And people are already using, this as well, these common variant findings in polygenic risk right? So you can stratify people in different arms of being very low risk or very high risk of various disorders. That can be very important as we think about, you know, high risk individuals or the prodrome, right? And I think a lot of, and also there's been a lot of research in that area using these polygenic risk scores to actually say, make statements about correlation between traits. And I think most interestingly is causal inferences, right? We know that, you know, moms, age that mom gets married is associated with schizophrenia. Well, what's the causal inference there? And so you can take the SNP data about marriage, age, and schizophrenia and say, oh, I see, it's actually the mom carried some risk for schizophrenia, polygenic risk for schizophrenia, that then increased risk for schizophrenia in her child, and that impacted her age of marriage. And it's not that because she got married young, she was more kind of socioeconomically deprived, and hence there were environmental sequelae. I mean, it could be both, but you can start to make, you know, everybody knows that autism is associated with perinatal events. Well, is that causal or not, right? Clearly, it's somewhat causal because you can't get hypoxia without getting some damage. But it looks like a lot of it's probably perinatal events are associated with the same genetic risk factors that cause autism, right? So it's an independent association. We can start doing that with this kind of data. So the other side of this, rarely is a major effect. These are the so-called low-hanging fruit in my mind, because when you find a mutation in a gene, you know the gene and you kind of know the direction almost all the time of which way the gene's going away. Well, so you know it's a loss of function rather than a slight change in expression either direction. And so what the field, and certainly here, Mark Baer and others have really led this field, and this is actually his figure, is as we find etiologies, in this case genetic etiologies for neuropsychiatric disorders, we can model them in rodents, cells in culture, you name it, and then really understand, study, you know, pathobiology in neurons in situ, which is hard to do in human populations. And so you really begin to learn something about the basic neurobiology and pathobiology of the disorder, and it can hopefully lead to some insight into what are the things you want to target that could be therapeutic, you know, can be therapeutic, and then you know, you take those novel therapeutics, you try them in your mouse first, and you go from there. So that's kind of the ground, that's kind of the foundation of what the ASC is trying to do, which is trying to find rare variants of major effect. And I'll go through very quickly where the ASC is today. ASC is the Autism Sequencing Consortium. This is the Simon Simplex Collection. So these are two major endeavors to get as much exome and now genome data from individuals with autism and controls. I'll talk primarily about the ASC. ASC is co-led by Mark, Ben, Catherine Reuter, Ernie Devlin, Catherine Reuter, Matt State, Stefan Sanders, some folks from Emory, and myself, with a lot of directed and important input from multiple sites, many sites. I think there are 50 sites right now in the ASC and 150 scientists. NIMH has been very involved. NHGRI has been very supportive through the CCDG. And the first study of the ASC was basically taking about 15,000 individuals, so either families, so a child, affected child with parents, or cases with very carefully matched controls, and then doing exome sequencing and mapping the findings to genes and processes. And the main findings were synaptic function genes, which wasn't that surprising, but was, I think, a little bit more novel was that there was an enormous number of mutations in chromatin remodeling genes, particularly, and I'll show you some pictures. Right. So this is, you know, this was at the time certainly the largest disease-oriented exome study in the business. This is the synapse in every gene here. That's not gray. We found a mutation in, so it's not a simple synaptic thing. A lot of it is glutamatergic synapses, but that's a lot of our brains are glutamatergic synapses. Some of it's GABA and other things as well. So there's not a single, even within synapses, there's not a single way to get to autism, right? And here is just one kind of histone-modifying enzyme family called methyltransferases and demethylases. So your histones, which the DNA is bound to, have these N-terminal tails and lysines that can be methylated and demethylated, and that process opens and closes chromatin and allows genes to be expressed. Okay. Everything in color here And actually, what's not in color, every gene that's listed here, we found a mutation in autism. And other groups found many more in the same family. It's not such a big family. So both the demethylases, both the methyltransferases in pink and the demethylases in blue and the readers in green, we found mutations in autism. And as I said, other groups just find more and more of these kinds of genes mutated in autism, intellectual disability, and even CHD. This is the other sample, the Simon Simplex collection. And we put the two data sets together for about 20,000 exomes. And the same thing, obviously, synaptic genes and chromatin remodeling genes. One of the nice things about having a true finding is it actually can be replicated. Very different from the early days of my genetic experience. So I mentioned these two enzymes that put on and take off methyl groups on lysines. This is the methyltransferases. And between our work, the Simon's work, and other kind of case report studies, I'd say about a third of these have mutations in developmental delay syndromes. And it's also true for the other side, for the enzymes that take away the demethylases. And some of these are really interesting. Some of them we just made KMT. We just made a mouse, yet another mouse. I think we're going to call all our mice yet another mouse and then a subscript. KMT2C, which is somewhere over there, I can't make it out myself, but a very interesting methyltransferase, and we put some fancy little tags on it so we could do pull downs, purify DNA, find what it binds to, and do some kind of biology on it. All right. The ASC has gotten bigger. The current data freeze that Mark and Kyle and others have put together. That 29,000 exomes. As you know, the Danish blood spots are being sequenced as well. That's going to be tens of thousands of samples with autism. So we're not too far away from 50,000 to 60,000 exomes in autism. This is separate from controls from exact. These are actually, every control was identified to be with a case, either that their parents or their ancestry match control. So it's a fairly robust data set. I mean, we're not there yet, but the 29,000 in the current freeze are in the final stages of being data cleaned. And you know, the Danish blood spots over the next 1 or 2 years will be out, and that'll all be a larger data set. And we continue to feed more samples into the machine. So we do expect, and we have a grant that's languishing, that, let me think of another word, a grant that we think is going to be funded at the NIMH, which will cover another 5 years, and we expect to get to many tens of thousands of exomes over that time with an enormous analytical kind of backbone to the whole thing. In fact, most of the money in the ASC goes to analysis. In fact, all of it does. So the other major consortium of interest is the DDD, the Deciphering Developmental Disabilities Consortium. Their paper on this data set, the 5,000-ish, just came out in Nature. So they've been systematically ascertaining trios across all the genetic testing sites in the UK. The target is 12,000. They have 12,800 samples. They're sequencing them all, 12,800 trios, all being sequenced. This is kind of the halfway point. And since there's so much overlap in risk between intellectual disability and autism, we put all this together and kind of looked at more autism risk, more ID risk, the combination. And it's very easy when you put these data sets together to find new genes that are at risk for one, the other, or both. And one thing that's for the neurobiologists is pretty exciting is that, that's not the best picture, but the genes that we're finding, many of them are involved in corticogenesis. As soon as I say histone-modifying genes that are already, you know, it's something early in development, and we actually map these genes because we have things like brain span and we know where genes are expressed, we can actually say where is this mostly happening, and it is, not surprisingly, first and second trimester. So autism happens before birth. I think that's pretty clear from the biology. It doesn't mean it can never happen after birth, but for the most part, it's before birth. And these colored things, there's blue and there's blue with red with, there's blue, red, and red with blue annuli. Those are genes and gene regulatory networks that we find mutations in autism, ID, or both. And this subset of the story is about corticogenesis, the layering of the brain, and projection neurons to different parts of the brain. Right? So it's kind of I'm not saying it's an easy biology, but it is a neurobiology that we understand that we can follow up on. There are very few postmortem autism samples compared to other disorders for a variety of reasons, but Eric Korshan's group has shown that cortical dysplasias are a feature of postmortem samples from autism consistent with some corticogenesis abnormalities. Right? So there's some relationship between the gene findings and the postmortem findings. So that's by way of kind of state of the art, state of genetics in autism. And I'm going to switch over to a disorder called PMS. And the tagline that the Family Foundation uses is, it's not what you think. PMS is not what you think, right? Tagline. And they get a chuckle. And they always give me a red t-shirt, and I very rarely wear it. I do sometimes. But, you know, my daughters have all torn it up and took off the collar and took off the sleeves, and they wear it around the house. But, yeah. So PMS is Phelan-McDermid syndrome. It used to be called, historically called 22q13 deletion syndrome. The families wanted a more family-friendly name, and they were very appreciative of Katie Phelan, and who kind of been not only described the syndrome about the same time as with McDermid, but also kind of advised them about creating a foundation and doing all the things they did. PMS is a subtelomeric deletion. At least we used to know it that way. Now we know point mutations as well. But the punchline of a lot of genetics is that the neurobehavioral phenotypes are mappable to a single gene called SHANK3. And I'll talk a lot about that. I'll talk too much about that. Lots of ways of getting it. As I said, there could be deletions. There could be balanced translocations in parents that produce an unbalanced chromosome copy in the child. Ring 22, we always knew this was a major cause in stress deletions, and I'll talk about these de novo point mutations, which really kind of convince us, I think beyond any doubt, that SHANK3 is the major player in the syndrome in terms of behavior and intellectual functioning. Known about it for some time, because long ago we could actually see chromosomes, so if there was a large bit of DNA missing from the terminal end of chromosome 22, you could see it. Ring 22 was a fairly well-described thing, even in the 70s. And if you looked at all the, if you look at these studies of ring 22, you find just what we would consider the hallmarks of Phelan-McDermid syndrome. In terms of everything, in terms of kind of structural abnormalities, dysplastic toenails, IQ deficits, milestone problems, hypotonia, autistic traits, whatever term they used at the time. Right. So we've known about it for a while. And one of the interesting things, I'm sure you're familiar with Gao Ping's work, very elegant work on this is that for many, many years we've known that this disorder, when you're missing that little terminal end of chromosome 22, there is a very, very high risk of psychosis, atypical, bipolar, whatever you want to call it. Here's an individual, 1985, patient's behavior was unmanageable, alternated between entirely passive with avoidance of eye contact, severely agitated with stereotype, so kind of a rapid cycling, bipolar, withdrawal, aggressive, depressed, all these kinds of things. This has been part of the literature for a long time, and if you go to the Facebook sites of the families, you see that a non-trivial proportion of them are experiencing this in their kids. So we need to understand that, because that's like, after all the bad news, now you're looking at new bad news, right? And there's also catatonia, and just horrible things can happen post-puberty and kind of in the early 20s. So this is one of the first kind of terminal deletions that wasn't a ring that was described. That's why it was called 22q13 deletion syndrome. And then over time, as people began to map the phenotype to the deletions, and because these are subtelomeric deletions, the breakpoint is not defined. It's not like a typical copy number variant where there's, So people would map different size deletions, all with very similar phenotypes, and it got the smaller and smaller and smaller region contained just three genes, one of which was SHANK3. And in that context, groups began to find that some of the breakpoints were actually in the gene itself. There were current breakpoints in the gene. And at that point, Bonaglia's group pretty much said, and I think everybody agreed, the gene in Phelan-McDermid syndrome is SHANK3. Right. That was the context for this important paper where the ascertainment was based on autism now and sequencing cases with autism, and they found what we would call Phelan-McDermid syndrome in three of their individuals. One was a de novo deletion, terminal deletion. So within Shank 3, so a recurrent breakpoint down to the end. The other was a trisomy, and with parental balanced trisomies, the child can be monosomy. Sorry, with balanced translocations in a parent, you get a monosomy child, you can get a trisomy child, and you can get a eusomy child, and they got all three. Here's one, an individual with three copies of the terminal end of chromosome 3, one copy and two copies. This individual has autism, intellectual disability. This one has Asperger's. Like all these genes, they're dose sensitive, right? Too much and too little isn't good. And then there was one family that had a single point mutation just in the gene, right? And that was kind of, in the context of all the other data, that N of one was enough to kind of really hit the nail on the head that there's no question that Shank 3 is the major driver of the neurobiology, neurobehavioral phenotypes in Phelan-McDermid syndrome. Nowadays, we have many more such mutations, not many, because most of the time people don't sequence. You probably can't see it here. Yes, you can. Most GC-rich gene in the genome, not easy to sequence, doesn't perform well in any of your sequencing assays. Exome sequencing, where there's PCR, really bad data. So even all the exome data, we really can't query most of the gene. We're still finding mutations in Shank 3 in the exome data, but it's only in a few exons that we can actually interrogate properly. The other exons that are GC-rich, which are the most mutagenic, we can't actually interrogate in our exome studies yet. All right, so if you put together all the relatively, I would say all the unbiased data on ascertaining by a phenotype and measuring deletions, ascertaining by a phenotype and sequencing hard, you get an estimate of that the total kind of risk of this kind of mutation in autism is between 0.5 and 1% of autism, which is non-trivial. It's trivial if you think that it's only 0.5% of autism, but other disorders that contribute, like Fragile X, Rett syndrome, and so on, are also in the same order. In fact, I would say this is more common than Rett, less common than Fragile X. And if you put the two phenotypes together of autism and intellectual disability, reasonably good studies suggest it's 2% of that population, which is very high for a very rare disorder associated with autism and intellectual disability. And so this kind of says the same thing in a different way, but you know, this is probably a minimal estimate of the rate of Phelan-McDermid syndrome. As we get more sequenced data, it tends to go, some people will say it's close to 1 in 5,000. And so it's fairly significant. It's on par, on the same order of things like Rett and Fragile X that you have heard about probably more than you heard about Phelan-McDermid syndrome. Well, maybe here you've heard about Phelan-McDermid syndrome. Most places it's kind of a, still somewhat of a new thing. The phenotypes, ID, absent or severely delayed speech, autistic traits, what they used to call, now we call autism, same thing. Behavioral disturbances, attentional deficits, I'll come back to that. Hypotonia, some structural, non-recurrent structural brain abnormalities, feeding difficulties, seizures. When we decided to get into this gene and this particular disorder, there had never been a prospective study of this syndrome. No site had actually brought people in and did a kind of a full phenotypic evaluation. There were sites, very good sites, that had medical records and so on, but to do kind of a prospective, detailed look at multiple facets of the disorder hadn't been done. So we brought in at first 25 patients. We were very lucky we got some philanthropy we could just kind of put at because the NIH was not interested at all. These are the first cases we saw, and this is mapped by the deletion size. Here's the end of chromosome 22. And again, there's varying sizes, including some that just have tiny deletions at the end terminal, at the telomere. And 80% MEC criteria for autism or autism spectrum. Look at the IQ distribution, profound intellectual disability, certainly the majority, right? Severe, moderate, a few with kind of typical IQs. You know, definitely motor abnormalities, no question about that. Did better on expressive language versus, on receptive language versus expressive language. That's also shown here. You know, these are very severe, these are the most severely affected kids that you can see, or adults, that you'll see in a typical autism study. And when you read about neuroimaging and autism, you're reading about, typically, the most highest functioning individuals. If they're in a scanner doing complicated tasks as part of an fMRI study, they are at the very top of the spectrum of severity. Okay. most of the people are not at the very top. The reality is that we have very few tools to study severely affected individuals, and most studies you hear about will not be studying those individuals. So we're missing a huge part of the spectrum, and in fact, we're missing the people that most need interventions. Right? That's true for ID as well. Intellectual disability, not a lot of studies of this kind in ID because it's a very difficult space, and people have not invested in trying to develop the tools to actually work in this space. So we made this commitment to focus on genetically defined autism without giving up the ongoing studies in idiopathic autism. We believe there's power in making a comparison. Thinking about developing tools to actually study people who are more severely affected. And we started with Shankly and Phelan-McDermid syndrome. We have other ones, FOXP1, Fragile X, a few others. And we have a lot of studies just in Phelan-McDermid. I'll talk about some of these, so I won't belabor this example. But, you know, I showed you about the assessment, just bringing people in, doing things, doing more and more, bringing in neurologists, cardiologists, kidney people, then doing things that are not clinical assessments like sensory studies, neuroimaging, ERP. I'll show you some data from that. Clinical trials, I'll talk a little bit about. We have a lot of iPSCs, and then we have animal models. So I'll go through these pretty quickly. So here is an example of neuroimaging, functional neuroimaging in individuals who you wouldn't be able to put in a scanner. So they're mildly sedated, and the task is very simple. You play sounds that are word-like and sounds that are not word-like. And everybody in this room, even when you're sleeping, your brain will activate differently to the speech-like sounds compared to the non-speech sounds. And the superior temporal sulcus is one area that universally, when you average a bunch of people together, you will see more activation to speech-like sounds versus non-speech-like sounds. It's true for infants, awake or asleep, even sedated. So the individuals with Phelan-McDermid syndrome actually show that response. In idiopathic autism, you don't see it. So in idiopathic autism, you don't see a special valence to social sounds. In PMS, that's preserved. So they have a strength here, and they're different from what people think of as garden variety autism. There's no such thing as garden variety autism, but when you write a paper and you say your animal doesn't have profound social deficits, the proper response is neither do the patients, right? I mean, the first response is there's no gene we actually have that only tracks with autism. There are plenty of genes where one person has autism, one person doesn't. There are genes on chromosome X where within a family, right, there's autism or not autism. But the other thing is that in Phelan-McDermid syndrome, you know, we also do socio-orientating. A lot of their social skills are preserved. They can't do the back and forth even with signs. They are so impaired in so many ways, attentionally, cognitively, and so on. They meet criteria for autism, but they don't have a core social aversion or deficit. Right? So we can build on that knowledge. All right, and then sensory processing is part of DSM-5. It's just such a catch-all. It has no real biological meaning because we lump together hypo and hypersensitivity. We lump together auditory, visual, and tactile. We don't, you know, and we often rely on patient report is most common, but parental report, okay? And those are not as reliable as we'd like to think they are. So how do you interrogate somebody about their sensory processing issues who's completely nonverbal, right? So we developed something called SASA, and SASA is a structured interview where you show things. You show visual things, spinning discs with or without lights. You play different sounds. You brush a feather, and you can then raters can then say this person is showing one of these three things is a DSM criteria of hypo, hyper, and seeking, sensory seeking, in each domain. And what you can see is, sure enough, in autism, idiopathic autism, they show hyperactivity, hypo-reactivity, and seeking behaviors across all the modalities. And so here are the three modalities, total scores. While Phelan-McDermid syndrome specifically and quite dramatically shows hypo-reactivity. Okay. Now, these are the kids that the parents will say they walk into something and they just have no reaction. They burn themselves, so there's no reaction. Right? So they have very severe sensory issues. But that's biologically different than somebody who's hypersensitive, almost certainly. It's unlikely to be the same exact thing. Right? So this is a new tool which many people are interested in because we can finally measure sensory processing in a meaningful way without parental report with all the issues that that has and without having to ask questions for the person involved. our other one that we're spending a lot, and hopefully not too much, a lot of time on, which is EEG-based measures. And we're doing regular EEG like everybody else with, you know, 126, 256 electrodes and so on. But that doesn't work for somebody who's severely impaired. You can't get that cap on them with any kind of reliability. They're not going to keep it on for a long trial. People do it, but they usually do it by, you know, bringing them in 12 times is typical, getting them desensitized to the cap, going through this very long process to finally get your EEG at the end of the day. Worth doing, but it'll never be clinically useful. Right? Clinically, you need to put something on and 2 minutes later get a response, right? These are EEGs with just three electrodes, 1, 2, 3. They can go on and we get usable data with 90 seconds. All right, we go all the way out to 5 minutes if everything's going really smoothly, but within 90 seconds to 2 minutes, we get enough data to say something important about the EEG of that individual. And these are evoke responses. We play a tone, we flash a light, and the brain shows very characteristic waveforms that we know very, very well, and we know just how they're synaptically connected and what regulates them. And so you can actually interrogate in just 2 minutes, is there hypoglutamatergia, hyper, complicated because once one thing's down, the next thing is also down because they're linked synaptically. But you can make, you can actually put people on kind of a 2x2 grid where you say they're kind of showing too much on the glutamate and too little in the GABA, right? And we think that kind of parsing, because it's neurobiologically based, will be very useful in idiopathic autism, right? In Phelan-McDermid syndrome, there is a huge loss of this first downward glutamate peak. Compare typical autism, Phelan-McDermid syndrome. Almost none, right? So that you're flashing a light, checkerboard switches, you know, all of our brains do this. Huge flood of glutamate release, right? There's just nothing going on there, right? The downstream, what's next is this GABA peak. It's also blunted, but it's blunted probably as a consequence of not having that first input to it, right? We can show that it changes by some of the, well, bands are changed. We can show that it changes that the deletions show much more blunting compared to the point mutation, so they are less severely neurobiologically affected. So we can begin to kind of map out some of the neurobiology of Phelan-McDermid syndrome, and we can ask questions about if we gave this person a drug, IGF-1 is the example, does this move, right? Do we see changes in neurobiology? Now we can also say, if you bring me 100 people with idiopathic autism, what proportion look like this? And the answer is maybe 30%, right? So if we're right that drug X works in Phelan-McDermid syndrome, the next obvious question is, does that same drug work in the 30% of individuals with autism that have the same EEG abnormality, right? So that's kind of, that's the dream, right? So I'll talk a little bit about clinical trials in the context of mouse models, and then I'll finish up. So this is published. We knocked out the gene. There are now 14 knockouts, is that about right? 13 or 14? Went from 0 to 14, it's just a matter of years. This was the knockout of, this really is the N-terminal, exons 4 through 9. And we spent a lot of time looking at heterozygotes because that's what the patients have. And there seems to be some deficits in social behaviors, some clear deficits in certain receptors, AMPA receptors particularly. Ping and many others showed as well. Did I just get my LTP slide? I'll show you the LTP slide next. For a variety of reasons, and I'll tell you honestly, the most important reason was that IGF-1 is already being used in kids, and we knew we could try it if it showed any efficacy. But the other one was that right here, there was a trial in Boston Children's on IGF-1 in Rett syndrome, and they shared all their protocols, and they were very friendly about it. But IGF-1 is also known to stimulate glutamatergic synapses, and particularly the PSDs. So weak biological rationale, strong practical rationale, we put IGF-1 in the animals. Right. So this is a long-term potentiation in heterozygotes, missing one copy of the gene. The wild types, you do a stimulation, and you've strengthened the connection between those synapses, right, in what's called long-term potentiation. Heterozygotes, it goes to baseline within 90 minutes, so they don't maintain this kind of so-called trace of memory. If they've gotten IGF-1 at clinical doses for 2 weeks, they do just as well as wild type. All right, and the behavioral things also, I think I have a slide. Motor abnormalities, I told you there's a lot of it in the kids and the adults. Here's wild type. Here's heterozygotes on a rotor rod. They fall off much more rapidly. They can't maintain. Give them IGF-1, and they do as well as controls, right? So that was enough, because there's so much safety data for this drug, to actually go back and do a safety and preliminary efficacy trial in a very small number of individuals, mostly because the cost was exorbitant. It cost $14,000 per individual for the drug alone. That's gone up and come back down a little bit. It's a crossover design. It's two injections a day. Families do not want to inject their kids twice a day without knowing that they have a good chance that they're not going to be on active compound. So either you do two arms and you do a open label extension for an expensive drug. You don't do that. You just do a crossover design so that sooner or later, everybody's on active compound. And in our primary endpoint of the ABC social withdrawal, there was a strong effect, positive effect of drug, and not so placebo. Also in repetitive behaviors, and we're just finishing replication. And we've always known, I actually don't want to look at the data because replication is the same size as the discovery set. We all know about winner's curse. There's no way it's going to replicate nicely. We've been arguing with the drug company for 3 years to give us drug for free to do multi-site, increase the N by fourfold, to have a good chance of seeing a finding. They're finally coming around. It turned out they were unable to make the drug for 2 years, but they kept that up. That's why they weren't willing to negotiate for some time. But now they're back in production, still only in Europe. They don't have an American site yet. So we have to have an IND to get the drug even to America. But they are interested enough now, I think, that we can do another trial, a bigger trial for free. Free for the drug. There's now an RDCRN that focuses on Phelan-McDermid syndrome. So there are multiple expert sites. There used to be zero. A lot of work. EU Ames has a significant effort in Phelan-McDermid syndrome. I've been to Spain 4 or 5 times, all over the world. You know, there's a lot of data sharing, a lot of interested families. So we have a second trial for IGF-1. And this is really, we actually just got another donation, a very significant one, to do this next step I told you about, which is, okay, let's try IGF-1 in idiopathic autism, but let's see whether our biomarkers can predict a subgroup that's more responsive. So that just started. That's a long way to go. All right, this is coming out today. I could still call it unpublished. I checked this morning because it wasn't out yet, but it's coming out in eLife today, and if it already come out, I'd say it's already published, so I can't talk about it. This should come out today, and basically it's genetically modified rat for Phelan-McDermid. Back in the dark days when zinc finger nucleases were all the rage. And so it's a ZFN targeting mechanism. So it's not as clean as CRISPR-Cas. But we targeted exon 6 because there was already a patient that had, there are a lot of mutations in this anchor and repeat domain. So we thought, good. And it was the N-terminal. We thought, that's good. We used to believe if you knock out the N-terminal, you knock out all isoforms. We now know that's not true. But it was also, but it is true that having a mutation just in this region is sufficient to produce, have the kind of neurobiological phenotypes. This, which one? Yaoping, you worked on that one, no. One of these, right? One of your point mutations, huh? Oh, it's further down? Okay. All right, none of these. Okay. So one of these mutations is a mutation that leads to an alternate acceptor site, and then it makes a frame shift. So this human individual has a premature stop, and by targeting exon six, we got a little bit lucky. We expected a frame shift over there, but we got one that kind of almost exactly matched the human mutation. One human mutation, but this is a pretty good reflection of it. Lots of behavioral phenotyping. And I'll show you just two results. The first is social recognition memory. You put rodents together, you take them apart, you put them back together with, you know, A and B are together, then you take them apart, and then you put A and B and another animal, C, in the same arena, and the animal B will spend more time with the novel animal than with the animal they kind of remember from 5 minutes ago or yesterday. Right? So this is the animal we're at, you know, this is the test. Well, this is the test animal. We put it together with a black animal. Next, 30 minutes later, put together a black animal and a gray animal. And sure enough, they spend a lot more time with the new animal, the gray animal, whether they have wild type, heterozygotes, or knockouts. However, if you wait a day, okay, the wild type animals still spend more time with the new gray, but heterozygotes or knockouts spend equal amount of time with the familiar and non-familiar animals. So they've somehow forgotten that they met this rat yesterday. I said that one of the striking things clinically is the attentional deficits. So we did five choice, so reaction time tasks in the rats, and no matter how much you train them, the heterozygotes and knockouts always had more errors, got fewer correct, got more errors, more omissions, and much higher latency, significantly higher latency, to do these tasks. The motivation was the same. They got the food as quickly as the other. They ran, you know, their motor deficits weren't impeding. They got to the food quickly. They moved around quickly. They ate the food quickly. All the drivers were there, but they had some what we interpret as attentional deficits in this task. There are EPHIS abnormalities, LTP, LTD, which has been a little, you know, all the mouse models I think show this. Some show LTD deficits, particularly in the knock and the full knockout, both copies missing. This is an LTP from the hippocampus to medial prefrontal cortex, and very clear deficits in the heterozygote and the knockout. So kind of cross-brain regions that we think are important. The neurobiology of social recognition memory is pretty well worked out. We actually know the major brain regions, and we know that oxytocin and vasopressin have specific roles in that pathway. And so it was a fairly trivial jump to say, let's try oxytocin in these animals. Oxytocin, as you know, is being tried in autism. It's still equivocal. The definitive or the perhaps the definitive trial, it's just completed now. So there was a network that got funded 5 years ago to do 300 individuals on oxytocin, a multi-site study, very well carried out. And so finally we have an oxytocin study that's at least reasonably powered. And I think the reason it got funded is because if you believe in oxytocin, of course you wanted it to happen. If you didn't believe in oxytocin, you wanted it to, for once and for all, be shut down. And everybody wins, right? No matter what the outcome. So that study, that ACE group, Autism Centers of Excellence Network, just finished enrollment end of last year, November, and data analysis is ongoing. But this is oxytocin in a specific genetically defined subgroup of autism, so it's a little bit different. Well, a rat, but you know where I'm going. So if you gave them oxytocin, and we did an injection, both the hets and the wild and the knockouts did perfectly fine the next day. So they recovered the social recognition memory thing that they had lost. What was surprising was that the oxytocin also corrected the attentional deficits. And when we first got this result, this was the first time anybody had seen an effect of oxytocin on non-social attention. Now there's a primate group seeing the same thing in primates, so we don't think it's that rare. But we think that this kind of tells us that the neurobiology, and by the way, the EPHIS, which I won't show you, LTP, LTD, and the connection between hippocampus and prefrontal cortex were also corrected, if you will, by oxytocin. So we think that they're all somehow related in pathways. This is unpublished work from the Grinvich lab. We're part of a consortium with them on this animal. And the oxytocinergic neurons in these animals are really, really bizarre. These varicosities that you see are as big as nuclei. You're not supposed to see that, right? So something's really wrong with the oxytocinergic system. And if it's true in patients, well, the obvious thing would be try oxytocin. Our center was already looking at oxytocin for decades. It was very easy to say, let's take the oxytocin we're trying in idiopathic autism, and let's start a trial in Phelan-McDermid syndrome. That's ongoing. And then I won't belabor it, but we obviously collect cells from everybody. We now have 15 pairs of cells. So we have a case and an unaffected sibling. That's how we pair them up. You can always ask, why don't we do CRISPR-Cas? And probably we should have at the beginning. But because the disorder, most patients have a deletion, we think there's also something useful actually using clinical material where the amount of material is different in different people. We're actually making a targeted CRISPR-Cas, targeted Shank3, but we also think it's important. If you have a drug that only works with the targeted locus, you haven't helped anybody. You want a drug that works, you know, whether the deletion is big or small, or for the greatest proportion of individuals. I don't need to tell you about that. Just to finish up, it's not so rare. Shank3 is sufficient for the behavioral and neurological phenotypes. If you have a point mutation there, you have everything else you see in Phelan-McDermid syndrome. You don't necessarily have the kidney abnormalities, but in terms of the brain, you have the same thing. We don't know a lot about it. I mentioned that, you know, there's emerging awareness of kind of this kind of, you know, post-puberty, early adulthood regression, psychosis, catatonia. You know, we don't have natural history studies in this disorder. It's pretty shocking. Regression, this kind of atypical schizophrenia, bipolar, catatonia. There are, you know, the first animals came out, were generated about 8 or 9 years ago. There are quite a few good papers out there that say, here's a therapeutic avenue, right? Are they being pursued or not? Well, it depends. Some companies are pursuing some of them, right? So it's been a big change in a very small amount of time. There are some RCTs going on, randomized clinical trials, and the ones we're doing now include this EEG-based evoke response, as well as the sensory and other things as well. And, you know, we think that this approach, the field thinks, that these kinds of approaches may move the field forward a bit more effectively. In the big picture, there are still some really kind of open questions. I won't belabor them. But comorbidity is an issue, and I'll show you why in ASC data in a minute. So we ascertain based on schizophrenia, and we ignore the fact that there's something else in that individual. We ascertain based on autism, we ignore intellectual disability. And then we say, oh my God, there's overlap in gene findings. How much of that is pleiotropy and how much of that is comorbidity? I'll show you some examples. And then I said this already, and I won't, you know, that 50%, right, of the risk for autism is common variation. We have to get a handle on that and understand how it manifests. Does it, for example, sculpt the phenotype? Because we know that, you know, 20 BCFS, 20 Du Jour syndrome increases risk for autism and schizophrenia. Is it the common variation that's pushing the final manifestation in one direction or the other? How do we put it all together? And that's really a critical part of our pie, a piece of the pie that we need to understand. This is from Elise Robertson showing that if you look at the rate of de novo mutations in an autism cohort, what you see is that it's driven by the low IQ individuals. And if you put together the DDD data, it's pretty clear that the de novo findings we're seeing in autism today are almost entirely, are largely driven by intellectual disability. We don't really have any autism genes that are not ID genes yet, right? So if you don't have that data, if you don't have the cognitive data in your sample, and at least for autism we kind of have it, but if it's other comorbid disorder, we probably don't, you would say these are autism genes. Nothing wrong, don't get me wrong. It's great to find ID genes. I think that's a disorder I call it the forgotten illness because nobody really studies it in the same way as people study other disorders. But we have to be aware that there's a whole, we can take the DDD data and the ASC data, those two data sets, and we can use them to estimate the number of genes in both disorders. And it looks like, to our best estimate, and we've been pretty accurate so far with autism, there are twice as many autism genes as ID genes. The ones we're finding are the ones that are shared because they're really driven by the ID phenotype. The ones that we're not finding, and maybe they'll come out of the iPsych study as a first example, are ones that are probably much more allied with autism and are more true, if you will, autism genes. But this is not just, ID and autism is an easy one, but other disorders, you know, we don't even have the phenotypes. That's what I said before, that here we are with all this variation that we don't have a good handle on. And the number of Shank3 genes is vanishingly small. Right? We already know, even in the top genes from the first ASC paper, there was a few, very few, that had odds ratios that are kind of up there in the near Mendelian. Very quickly, you got down to odds ratios of about 5, and then right down there to 2, 1, right down to the SNPs. We're not going to find a lot of genes of major effect for autism. I mean, in ID, because it sounds like one gets the, there's reason to believe that in ID, we're getting close to saturation actually for the genes. X chromosome, not well, underpowered right now in the ASC. There'll be more kind of high-risk genes on X as we go forward, but it's not going to be lots and lots and lots and lots of them. They're not going to be hundreds. It's not a series of Mendelian disorders. That's clearly not the case. There are a few high-risk genes, some intermediate-risk genes, and a whole bunch down here at very low risk. And kind of grappling with that complexity and using all the genetic findings to understand neurobiology is really the challenge of the field, right? This is one study that showed that if you look at the interaction between polygenic risk and rare variation, you can actually say that there's polygenic risk in all these families, or many of these families. If you back out the rare variation, you reduce, significantly reduce the odds of having autism. So somehow, so the rare variation can often happen in the context of a family at risk, okay? And so the punchline really here is that it's an additive genetic disorder, duh. Right, that's anybody, people would have told you that a long time ago, but we're kind of coming back to it now from a more molecular understanding that even in the high-risk cases, there's also underlying genetic background that's important. And for almost everybody, there aren't any obvious higher risk. It's all intermediate risk, lower risk, interaction of effects. I'm going to stop here and say that I talked about the ASC and the leadership of that, and of course the NIMH, Thomas Lehner and Gita Sental have really kind of been drivers, been very supportive. Some of the, I've shown you a lot of CBER Center work, both clinical and preclinical. With the Mount Sinai, we have some people from the Department of Neuroscience that have been very helpful. Albert Einstein came in. This is my favorite collaborator. He's my son-in-law. So after he got, after he got engaged to my daughter, we needed some experiments. And I said, hey, Matt. Pressure I put him under to do this experiment for me was fairly intense, but and he couldn't really say no because we were. So he knocked it out. He was just finishing his MD PhD. He was looking at residencies. He knocked out some electrophysiology experiments over the course of a few weekends before the wedding, and I was like, "You got no choice." And then this is the Human Frontiers Science Human Frontiers project that involves four sites across the world looking at these rats and the oxygenergic signaling in the rats. So I'll stop there, and maybe there's time for a question or two. I don't know.